Hi, I'm Pastor Tommy. I'm senior pastor over at Asbury Church and also executive director of Asbury Community Development Corporation, or nonprofit at Asbury. Cindy and I are building a new home in preparation for retirement. And we've decided to act as the general contractor, so it's really up to us to lock in and schedule 20 or so contractors who will be doing everything from the excavating to hooking us up to the electrical grid. For me, what has been making this so complicated, though, is getting a schedule together that everybody can agree on. I mean, most of us have experience with coordinating schedules for meetings and the like. But advances in technologies like SurveyMonkey and electronic calendar, they bring multiple people together at a mutually agreeable time. It really helps, but ultimately the success depends on each person agreeing to do what they say they're going to do. Otherwise, we show up on different days at different times and the meeting doesn't happen. Now, growing up, my parents told my siblings and me over and over how important it was to follow through on commitments. Most of you have heard the lessons. You're only as good as the promises you keep. Don't say one thing and do another. Son, trust is built on doing what you say. And then we become adults, we become parents, and most of us learn the familiar expression, "Do as I say, not as I do." In Luke, Jesus tells this parable about a Pharisee who goes to the temple to pray. While the Pharisee's there, he notices he's standing next to a tax collector, and he decides to put some distance between him and this other person. And he moves away, and then he prays out loud enough that others can hear, "I thank you, God, that I am not like everybody else." And then he adds in, "Thank God I'm not like that man over there." Now, the Pharisee wasn't wrong. He isn't like anyone else. Scripture tells us that each one of us is wonderfully and beautifully made. I mean, after all, we're each a unique work of divine art. And Pharisees knew scripture. I mean, they knew it well. They could quote scripture, they could apply God's word to life situations. They taught others how to live a righteous life. And tax collectors? Well, tax collectors in that time, in first century, generally conspired with Roman officials. They were notorious for cheating people. Ordinary folks didn't hang out with tax collectors. Of course, the Pharisee wasn't like that man over there. And thank God he wasn't. On the other hand, in Matthew, Jesus tells us to listen to Pharisees, but don't imitate them. What's up with that? I think Pharisees get a bad rap in the Bible. They do, I think, because they're supposed to. Even though Pharisees were teachers and biblical scholars, even though they paid very close attention to even measuring out 10% of their spices because tithing was so important, there was something about their approach, something about the words that came out of the Pharisee's mouth that really leveled the playing field between the Pharisee and the tax collector when it comes to righteousness. It seems that the words of the Pharisee portrayed a different heart condition than what his words claimed he had. If someone said something to the Pharisee at the time, what do you suppose his response would have been? I think he'd be confused. For me, though, a Pharisee is a mirror. I think we're supposed to be disgusted by the Pharisee's behavior. And then when we see ourselves in a mirror, when we see the Pharisee in front of us, I think the lesson becomes that much more effective. A Pharisee, you see, is anyone who may know God's word quite well, can quote scripture with uncanny accuracy. But when there's a disconnect between what we say and what we do? Well, most translations of Scripture will choose the word hypocrisy for this condition. Honestly, what I remember most about church, even, you know, when I was a young person, a teenager, was the disconnect between what the preacher would say on a Sunday and what I observed, sometimes even during the sermon. This left a lasting impression on me. But the lesson I learned was to have an excuse for my own hypocrisy. And so as an adult churchgoer, as a young adult in particular, I showed up on Sunday at Sunday worship. I served on committees. I convinced myself that I was fulfilling my obligation as a Christian, father, neighbor, Pharisee. Speaking through the prophet Isaiah, God tells us that it isn't just quoting Scripture that's important. It's what we do with the Scripture that makes all the difference. God's word says that we need to work together to eliminate all forms of oppression and injustice. God tells us to share our food with the hungry, provide shelter for the homeless, give clothes to those who have nothing to wear. And centuries later, Jesus reminds us of the importance of what we do with Scripture. In Matthew 25, Jesus reveals that whenever we offer a drink to the thirsty, food to the hungry, clothing to those without, whenever we're providing basic needs for those who are in need, we're doing that for Christ himself. The truth is that we're all guilty at one time or another of saying one thing but doing another. Thank God we're not like everyone else. Thank God that each of us is created in God's image. Thank God that the Holy Spirit will guide us closer to God and to one another. But let us pray. Lord, we give you thanks that we are not like others. We give you thanks that each of us are wonderfully and beautifully made. Lord, thank you. Lord, help us to not just hear the word and say the word, but Lord, help us to also live it out in everything that we do with each decision that we make. Through the power of your Holy Spirit, Lord, help us to be doers and not just hearers. We pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you and have a blessed day.